a sound you hear that lingers in your ear, but you can't forget from sundown to sunset.
Guten Abend, Oma.
Guten Abend.
Guten Abend,
Nadine.
Bonjour.
Hey, Pasch. Guten Abend.
Hey.
Peter from Basement 45.
Guten Abend. Hallo.
So nice to see you, to have you again. Yeah, after last week's Blue Note, we have this week's Soul Music Stream. We will get into the music. We have quite some experts here, with especially with Nadine, the well-known, famous soul disco queen of YouTube. But before we get into the soul music and into the topic and listen to some amazing soul records, talk about the music genre, we have an unbelievable cool record at the OBC shop right now from David Bowie, and Thomas just showed the jacket to us. And I really want to share this record because I haven't seen anything like it. Please show us the jacket and what this jacket can do. I think it's a German pressing of the man who fell to earth, David Bowie. And look at the jacket. This is unbelievable.
Nice.
That's so cool.
It's beautiful.
Wow.
Yeah, it's Dave, the first time I ever had it.
Yeah, Dave, just very short. As you are quite a David Bowie expert, have you seen this edition?
No, I've not seen that one before. I've seen the, obviously the British, the rare, You know, there's lots of nice rare Bowie, obviously with cool sleeves, but that one's new on me. Never seen that over here. Really, yeah. I love those fold out, you know. It looks in really good condition as well, because those sleeves, they do tend to get quite damaged along the, you know, where the folds are. You know, a bit like the one that comes to mind, you know, the small faces sleeve that's all circular and sort of folds up. It always falls apart. And I know that one's a big circle, but still, looks really, really nice. Very, very nice.
Thanks for showing that. So if you're interested in this one, it's at the OBC shop. Okay, now let's start with the soul stream, and of course hello to all to you, Thorsten, Betze, David, Black Paint. I am the DJ. Nadine, you are here too. Tor, Frank, Andy, Manfred, Justin. Wow, so nice that you're all again here. What did we start today's stream with?
With an homage. We started with an homage.
Exactly.
To the great Marlena Shaw.
And why an homage? She recently died, right?
Yeah, like 2 days ago she passed away. And that's one of her best albums. And also her version of California Soul we've just heard is just fantastic. And of course, her records got, after she died, a little more expensive. But this
that's always right.
Awesome.
It always happens. Always.
It didn't happen with Thriller.
No, it didn't.
Thomas, I spotted that song Cadet. Is that correct? Cadet?
Sorry?
I spotted that song Cadet Records, which is obviously a great label. I Dorothy Ashby comes to mind. Yeah. So. I take it that's the same Cadet, yeah? Interesting. Yeah, very nice.
So they have put out a Vinyl Me Please box set of the Cadet records, right?
Yep. And, yeah.
Nadine, Soul.
Michael, I have a soul.
as you're quite fond of soul and immensely knowledgeable, when did all this start with the soul? Who have been the first artists in the genre? Can you give us a short overview?
Yes, in the end of the 50s, there was like R&B and blues and everything coming up, and like artists like Sam Cooke, for example, started to get into soul. Ray Charles is very well known for also being a pioneer in soul music. So in at the late 50s, early 60s, this genre kind of started to exist in a way, or getting more into mainstream. And then we have, of course, artists like also in the early 60s, like Aretha Franklin, we had James Brown, and of course, some girl groups coming up like the Shirelles. Great story to the Shirelles. So everybody's kind of saying, yeah, the Supremes were the girl group of the 60s and the first girl group who had 5 number one hits on Billboard. But actually, the Shirelles, way up earlier, had a number one hit as, I think, the first girl group ever. And they were African-American, and they had a number one hit, Will You Love Me Tomorrow? And this is great. And, you know, they were in a record company. It's always the same old story. And they had a manager, and the woman said, you know, when you ladies are 21, I build up a trust, and you get all the money from the records and the concerts. And they were really working hard. And when they got 21, there was no trust. So they got pretty much screwed up, like many artists in the 60s.
Yeah, okay. That's not so cool, right? But this girl group phenomenon, did that come up with the soul girl group, or has that been happening before? Or was that something typical for the soul genre?
No, you also had the Andrew Sisters, and also in the 40s and 50s, girl groups, always in different genres. But with Motown having this whole system behind you, because when you were in Motown, you came there, they looked, how do you look? How do you dress? How do you behave on television? How do you look into the camera? Choreography, you know, they had to practice and rehearse. And the Supremes was one of the group who really had to go to this quality control over and over again. Don't stare this way. Yeah. This is a great one. And so they were really, and the Vandals, Martha Reeve, of course, Miss Mary Wells, she sang duets with Marvin Gaye. So the girl group phenomenon was really pushed forward with Motown and the Supremes. And you have to consider the Supremes were on Ed Sullivan's show and everybody, and especially for the African-American group, these kind of people were idols. They were seen on TV in a time where a 5-year-old Ruby Andrews, she was an African-American girl, and she was the first African-American girl to attend a school, and she was escorted by police. And like being 5 years old, and there were women outside the school having little coffins with a black baby, and then I said, poison you, and we kill you, we kill your parents. And you have to consider what these people had to go through during that time. So having now the Supremes, the Temptations, like all of these, once again, a Martha Reeves one. I have this signed, by the way. going through this, this is such a great impact to now see them on TV and having role models, and we can be successful and we can be somebody. So that's the thing. So Motown has a great part of it, like also other labels like Chess, like Cadet. So
Tom, Dave, you want to say something?
We talked about the Supremes. The Supremes were actually known for the group that had no hit.
Exactly.
No hit. So it was only when they got into the dream team of the writers that they started.
You know, they didn't
like the songs themselves, like the biggest hit.
So the thing was also, Holland Dozier Holland was a writing team with Motown, and they were responsible for Martha Reeve and the Vandals. So when Diana Ross got closer with Barry White, the label owner, he switched the songwriting teams to the Supremes, and Martha and the Vandals were quite successful with Heat Wave and all of these songs. And then they changed the songwriting team, Eddie Holland and Dozier, and they were so successful with You Can't Hurry Love, Stop in the Name of Love, and all of these hits. And before they were called the Supremes, I think they were called the Primettes. And Florence Ballard was actually a founding member of the Supremes, but later on got in, I think 1967, kicked out of the group.
Thomas, you have a record for us? We can listen to some music?
Yeah, I think we changed a little bit. It's one of my favorite soul tracks. Here it is.
The dark brown shades of my skin.
This is best.
Only add color to my tears. Oh, oh, that splash against my hollow bones. That rocks my soul. Oh, oh, oh. Looking back over my false dreams that I once knew.
What are we talking about, Thomas? Which year? Which label? The record itself? When did you get it?
It's 1970, and it's on a small label that I don't know what that was about.
Trinite.
Trinite Records, looking like this.
Dave, now, label. You know this?
No, I don't. No. As you know, I'm a bit with the soul. I'm here with learning experience, but that track was very cool. I like the sleeve. Yeah, yes. I very much like the record label itself. I'm quite interested. I'll tell you what I'm interested in, because soul, you know, there's a real production, a real sound behind it. And I think, you know, with soul, I think the actual musicianship and production teams are very important. Yeah. And particularly, obviously, with the bigger, like the Motown sound. It's very distinctive as well. And it's interesting that to hear something that's maybe a bit, you know, like Thomas, it's a small label. I find it interesting to hear some of these other things, you know. And it, obviously, it's got that classic Thomas breaky beat thing going on behind it, yeah, which I know he loves. So, yeah, very good.
Nice one. Yeah, that was an amazing one, yeah. So Nadine, I bet you are aware of this artist.
I am, and this record we've just heard is one of his biggest success. So afterwards, he couldn't really get back to the success he had with that, and slowly vanished a bit. But he's undoubtedly a fantastic artist, and what a powerful song that was.
Is it accessible, the record?
Depending on the price, Peter.
Okay, so yeah, got it.
So again, when it comes to soul, we have like in many cases, we have a huge variety, right? We have really, really records that are out there for a very reasonable price, but it also gets into quite crazy amounts, right? Topics. Absolutely.
It still hurts, Michael. It still hurts. Yeah, it still hurts. Yeah, sometimes what happened during the recent couple of years is that you bought soul records like €10 or $10 or 20, yeah. And now they are 200,
right,
or 150. And also you have the problem of finding them in good condition. Finding early Aretha Franklin albums in good condition is very, very difficult, even in the United States.
So the people actually listened to their records back in the day, like really, really?
Yeah, they had this strange habit and listened to them.
They listened the shit out of it.
They were party rock.
Thomas, when did you get into collecting soul records? When did you get into the music? When was that?
I DJed from 1979 until 1989.
Yeah.
And at that point, it was mostly disco rock records that I played. But when I moved to Copenhagen, I had a friend who I knew before. He'd been DJed for 45 years, and he knew all the black music. And I started to hear what he liked and which one was the good records. And from that point, I started to look up for soul records and funk records.
It's always the same, right? And usually, you need somebody who opens those doors for you, give you some hints and some signs and some recommendations. And when you have those, you go by yourself. But you have to have someone, somebody who opens those doors. Yeah, it's always the same.
Well, it depends. For me, it was the internet that opened many doors. So back in the day, the late 90s, that's when you had Yahoo groups. Maybe some of you remember Yahoo, the search engine, and they had Yahoo groups. And people made rips from records, and you downloaded them as MP3. And this was my entry point and seeing, oh, this is there, that is there, because I didn't know anybody who was really into that genre, especially up here in Germany. Mm-hmm. And so that was my way of learning the things.
Dave, Great Britain and Soul, Dave Parsons and Soul. Any connections, any dots, or is that a genre? Because you're very versatile usually when it comes to music.
Yeah, I mean, I've not got the depth that Nadine and Thomas have, but I do have a few, but it's more sort of some of the more well-known things. But what I would say, what I find interesting, what you've got to remember, in the UK, we did have this whole Northern Soul scene. They call it Northern Soul. Yeah. And this is because it was a scene where a lot of these 7-inches, so small, you know, 7-inches, small artists were being pressed up in Detroit, and they were being imported over to the UK, and they really found a home in the north of England. Yeah.
Yeah.
The famous place being Wigan Casino. Yeah. And it's legendary. You know, you can see footage online of it. And a lot of these records were being bought, and they really took and really found a home for this music up there. And they were, you know, it's interesting that a lot of these Northern Soul records, they turn up here, yeah. And they're, I mean, we talk about money, about the albums, but these sevens, I mean, some of them go for thousands, you know. And
that's unbelievable, too. Yeah.
Yeah, they're legendary collectors in this scene as well. And I have had some exposure to that. Not from buying seven, you know, these seven, it's not really my area. But what I would say is I've given some compilations from a very big collector, and used to cut these sevens and make CDs of them called You're Never Too Old to Backflip. And that's how I got exposure to a lot of this music, you know, just purely from a listening respect, but not actually trying to hunt down and score the actual original 7-inches themselves. But it was a great way to hear some of it. You know, that's at the end of the day, that's what we want, you know. So, yeah. Yeah, we got a good. There's been a lot going on here with the soul, and there's all the early DJs with the whole R&B scene, you know, and groove, and it kind of amalgamated with. There's a bit of crossover with the jazz as well. So there was a lot of clubs around that were playing that in the early days here. Yeah,
nice. Before we get into this topic of the 7-inches, because I have a couple of questions there, Thomas, do you have some music for?
I do have some music for you, but I will just say one thing with the Northern Soul.
Of course.
The records are so rare that sometimes I have a friend here in Copenhagen who make the Soul Weekends. They hire a DJ just because he has one of the 7-inches, just because one song they want to hear. We get him in. He has
because he has the 7-inch. He's not a nice person, but he has the 7-inch, right?
Specific one, right, that wants to be played out. So you have to get that DJ just to get that one record played.
Yeah. Fly him in and pay hotel and everything just to play that song.
Wow.
Just hello everyone. On the topic of Northern Soul, that's the most bootlegged records, by the way.
Stunty, I can imagine.
What a great entry point there, mate. Great entry. It's important because of the value. You're right. I mean, Stunty, tell us. It's interesting that. It's really interesting.
Yeah. I remember, I think it was like 3 years ago, the biggest bust ever in record bootlegging was Northern Soul. A bunch of guys in London maybe in the north of England. They had to pay a fine of several million pounds just because of bootlegging. Like a few thousand 7-inches of Northern Soul, and as Dave was saying, some of these, they like, it's a bit insane. I have a friend who had who has one of the best collection of Northern Soul, and now he realized like what have I done with my life, and he's selling everything.
But okay.
Because it's very niche, that's also the thing. Like if you like it, it's gonna be almost the alpha and the omega. The people who are into that heavily, usually that's the only thing they're into. There's not really much room for anything else when you're really into Northern Soul.
Specific, isn't it? It's an area where they don't really venture outside of it. It's very Northern Soul, and you know, it's they are, you know, obsessed. It's a really upset, you know, it's a very specific scene. And you know, that Stunty's right, you know, a lot of these sevens, they came with very simple labels. You know, some of them were covered over. I remember, you know, there's all these stories, so DJs didn't want to show what record they were playing in the club, so they would cover them over so you couldn't read what the music was, because otherwise other DJs would try and get the record so they could play it as well. It's like that. I mean, it's a you know, unbelievable it is.
So actually the bootlegging of the Northern Soul record started in the 70s, in the early 70s. Mm-hmm. They already started the bootlegging thing. You have to consider it might have been not to make money out of it, but the rarity of the things, and people wanted those records, and somehow you have a certain amount you can bring over to the UK and that's it. So a friend of mine, when I was in Blackpool at the Soul Festival, he showed me the difference between a 70s bootleg and the original. So the 70s bootlegs, they were way thinner than the original vinyl. So this is how you knew the difference. The labels and everything was almost an exact copy. So you can really find out if it's a thin vinyl, then it's bootleg. If not, so nowadays it's getting really difficult to, is it a bootleg or is it an original? Because those people really gotten very good at that.
I had a discussion with Dave earlier this week about that specific topic, how good bootlegs can be right now. And I have pressed a few bootlegs because like that's the clients that come to you when you have a pressing plans. Sometimes you know, sometimes you don't, and sometimes the length they go to is like really, really surprising. Because of course, like for example, for 7 inches you have a big hole usually, and so the way the screw that you attach the stamper on the mold there is like you'd have to find a screw that has the same pattern as the one from when the record was done. And they do that. There's so much money into that that they actually go through the process of providing record plants with the exact molds, screws, and stampers that will actually rematch. They will even go to the length that they will look at the original record and look how the groove looks and hire a lacquer cutting engineer who will understand why it looks like that and how he should press on the pedal, on the foot pedal when he's doing that. It's insane.
Okay, before we go further into the 7 inches and the bootlegs, let's listen to some music.
Please.
Yeah. Yes. Many things sing in Japan. Don't give up. Hang on in there.
There ain't no time. No time for sorrow. And we ain't got time. Time to be saved. And maybe the world,
I like the writing on the record.
But to understand for my love, yo.
That's when they broke up. Then he kept the record, but
no,
no, it's over.
Did you hear your mom and daddy say, oh child?
But Thomas, here we have this good example of this very, very, very soft, nice, mellow, sweet soul, right?
Yeah, I think this has a jazzy feeling to it as well, which I think it's not just only a beauty song. It has a roughness to it as well that I like, and it has a personality that makes it. It doesn't sound like any other of the soul songs.
Okay.
Yeah. Got that driving Thomas beat going on as well,
and the drum sounds as well.
I don't have a record without the beats.
Nadine, you probably know this.
Isn't this Kirkland?
It is, yes.
Yeah. And that's a very rare one to find. This is a not cheap one, and if you find it as an original, go and grab it. It's amazing, to say it in Michael words.
So by the way, a lot of the records you see on the wall or at the wall you listen to today, you can also look up at the OBC shop. There is a link in the video description now down below. Like we did with the Blue Note last week, we have quite some soul records up there. There will be more, right? There also will be more Blue Notes, right? So in a way, for you, if you want to look at those records or maybe get one of those records, you can look at the OBC shop only or almost on a daily basis. We have there new records from Dave and Thomas almost on a daily basis. So.
Michael, can I choose a record from the wall to listen to?
Of course you can choose it. Everybody, the gallery, everybody can choose
everybody.
From the
so
wall.
So I would love Thomas to pick up the Ronettes.
Yeah.
Which was produced by Phil Spector. And also this one got very rare. If you find it, grab it. This is also, Amy Winehouse took a lot of inspiration from that one. Yeah, featuring Veronica. You see that look on that cover?
So of Amy Winehouse. Amy Winehouse.
Copies a lot of that that style. So maybe we can listen to the biggest hit on the record just for a few.
Yeah, moments. Don't. It does not get turned down.
I was just going to mention with this as well. Phil, it's important to mention Phil Spector. And again, I was going on about production. His production is so unique. You know, when you hear it, you know it's Phil Spector. His famous wall of sound, and very distinctive. And I think, you know, it's interesting to listen to this, to now hear these differences in the production,
True. So, as soon
here it
as...
is.
Oh, bring it to me.
Now let's see what happens to the stream.
Ah, come on.
Oh, it puts a smile at your face.
Beautiful. Never let you go.
And now let's see what Stunty does. Stunty,
no, I was just thinking about how afraid you must be right now. But like, what?
Oh my god.
I would have never brought this cover and the song together because I didn't know.
Okay.
And of course I know the song, but I would have never.
Oh my god. Yeah. Please. One of
Stunty.
Biggest
Stunty, you are not a person that I would directly connect to soul music, but you've surprised me quite some time. So how is your personal approach to soul music? And please don't mention Nurse with Wound in the answer.
I have two blind corners. One that is actually making fun of, which is metal, and the other one is soul music. And it's kind of because of the reasons that that were just expressed, like traditional soul music is not really heavy on the percussion and the rhythm, like real. And also there's another factor, like real, like what is being called like the classic soul music. There's not that many albums. There's actually just a bunch of hundreds, if you want to say like soul funk, rhythm and blues, or all that disco, yeah, but like real, like honest to God soul music, there's not like, yeah, there's not hundreds and hundreds of records. So if you're not into 7 inches, because it is, as you, as obviously you've discussed before I arrived, it is the by as with punk, it's the style of music that probably is the most like dependent on 7 inches. And I have a lot of 7 inches, but almost reluctantly, a bit like you, Michael. Like I get 7 inches only when there's something that is only on 7 inch and exceptional.
Yeah, get it. Okay, we're still here, although we played quite famous song. That's amazing, Nadine. Because that's, I have a question that I never understood when it comes to your collection and. Because you are heavily into soul, and you don't collect 7 inches.
I have a couple up there, But the thing is, going down this rabbit hole, like David said it very much, it never ends. It's super, super, duper expensive. And for me, it's the point, I enjoy an album, I put it on, I have 15 minutes to sit to enjoy, turned aside, and so you, with 7 inches, it's always inconvenient for me. There are fantastic tracks, and maybe the group only recorded this one song. You have the instrumental side. So for me, this was never really a thing. I totally get that point, and I do understand everybody who's into 7 inches. There are fantastic songs out there, but this rabbit hole never, never ends. But I wanted to point out, somebody asked about some compilation album from Northern Soul.
Exactly. Yeah.
We have Wigan Casino number 2. I also have number 1, where also Dave mentioned that this that there was the partying happening. And you can see it from 1973 till 1981, and I think in the early 80s also this dried up a little bit, and Wigan Casino closed. But you can see these people had fun. We have the Nightlife, which is also a great compilation. And
which years did those compilations came out, and are they relatively easy to get, or is it also difficult?
You can find them. They came out like 5-4 years ago. I bought them when I was in the UK on Blackpool, and also just on short notice found Shades of Soul, Crossover, and Modern Soul, which is more down my alley. So you easily find some great compilations from Northern Soul. And also Disco Devil asked me to show him this one. Yes, it's an original. Found it early this year. Super happy about it. So my two cents.
Okay, cool. Just got an email. So Thomas. Before we did start our stream, we talked a bit about the 7 inches, and you already mentioned an interesting fact that that you also have those 7 inches because the artists, they didn't have money, and putting out 1 7-inch was the easiest and by far cheapest way of doing it, right?
Yeah, and, most of the time they didn't have enough tracks to do an album. They just had a few songs.
So there are artists that put out only 1 7-inch, and that's it, right?
Yeah, there's many of
Michael,
those.
You have to remember that, like, the biggest media for soul music back then was the jukebox. So there was no need of albums.
You think that's the reason? Okay, interesting.
Well, that's part of it, for sure.
Yeah. That's a great point by Stunty. Because you have to consider in the 60s, when black artists put out music, what was the audience who bought that music? Also, African-American people. So, and they didn't have that much income, so they preferred to buy a single instead of an album. That changed in 1969 when Isaac Hayes released Hot Buttered Soul. So the thing was that Atlantic had a distribution deal with Stax Record, which is a very famously soul label. And the distribution deal was very favorable for Atlantic. So Atlantic got all the back catalog from Stax, like Otis Redding, they got Sam and Dave, they got all the things they got before 1969. So Stax had actually no back catalog. And the record owner of Stax said, you know what, we do a program, we call it Soul Explosion, and I want to release as fast as possible over 20 albums. So he got to Isaac Hayes, and Isaac Hayes was in a deep depression at that time. So when Martin Luther King was shot in 1968 in Memphis, he was supposed to meet him at that day, because it was also in the civil rights movement, and he got into a deep depression. And when he got asked to do an album, he said, okay, but I want all the creative freedom. I want to do whatever I want to do. Yeah. And the record owner said, you know, Isaac, I don't care what you do, but release albums. And then Hot Buttered Soul came out and was a full-length album, and it featured in total 4 tracks. And 18 minutes of By the Time I Get to Phoenix, Walk On By, he did this absolute masterpiece. And when you see the cover of the album, he's there with his bold hair and wearing a gold chain, which is actually a symbol for slavery. And he put it on as a symbol of pride. And he said, if I can really do something in a civil rights movement, I want to prove that I can be successful. And with releasing this album, he kind of changed the direction from singles to albums.
Okay, that's the importance of this album. Interesting. Thank you.
It's interesting Nadine mentions 1969 as a turning point, because there was another big turning point for this kind of for soul music, I would assume, which is the recording of Let It Be, the first time the Beatles had anyone else but the Beatles as a credit, and it was a soul musician, Billy B. Preston.
And actually,
a huge influence.
Let It Be was actually written, or was offered, I think, from John Lennon to Aretha Franklin. And she took way too long to record it. And then the Beatles decided, okay, we record it ourselves. She later did a cover version of it, but she was offered that song. And that's the iconic Isaac Hayes Hot Buttered Soul album. It's just a masterpiece. So everybody who's not into soul and to saying, okay, what kind of soul album do I need in my collection? This is one of the albums.
But to listen to this would crash the stream, right?
It's 18 minutes off by the time.
Let's go.
You can play like the middle part of Walk On By from Hot Buttered Soul, because this has jazz elements, it has a psychedelic guitar in it, maybe some parts of Walk On By.
But I can imagine Thomas already did some track, so give him some time, or shall we switch the records? Okay, we can do both.
And exactly.
I saw that Liam was saying, because he said we need to address the Northern Soul dancing. And I've got to say, you must go and watch, because those people, they were like lunatics in the room, you know, going mental all night long. And there's all the stories about what they would do is they would put on the dance floor, I think it was like sort of fine sand to make it more slippy. So they could all do all this mad, you must watch it online to see, because it was. I mean, these are like, I suppose it's the sort of precursor to raves, really. You could probably go back to that. Yeah.
It's funny you say that. There's actually a connection between the Gabber scene and Northern Soul. Northern Soul and mods were quite connected as well.
Yeah,
you have to tell that, and you know that probably better than me. But there was a movement in northern Italy in the 80s of Gabber music that was quite different than the Gabber techno from the Netherlands, and they used like the codes, the closing codes and all that. That was directly influenced by stuff from the Northern Soul and the dancing as well.
Yeah, and they also wear special shoes and special trousers when they go on dancing, and they also have shoes from sneakers to those dancing shoes. And like Dave said, I've seen it in Blackpool, like all night long in the movements. And when a certain highlight comes up, a highlight song, like everybody is storming the dance floor, and these people are 70, 80 plus. I didn't even know that they were able to move that way. You know, sitting almost in a wheelchair, and that song plays, and they go straight up the dance floor.
Thomas, are we ready for music?
We can hear a little bit of the Isaac Hayes.
Okay.
I love the intro. So can we have the intro and then because I love the intro.
It's yeah. Amazing. This is.
That's epic. Maybe as a later point, when you come around it, hey, Joe is asking if you can put up the Magnum fully loaded.
Yeah.
If you have it.
It's on the wall. It's a killer record.
Yes. Yeah, I think because hey, Joe had an eye on it.
Yeah, and Snake Oil is right. Also, Isaac took inspiration from back in the day from the Western score, the Western soundtracks, with orchestral influences. He took that as well into the songs.
Okay.
Ah, oh, it's a beautiful album. No, but Joe, this, it's not.
But this incredible length of those songs, is that something new at the time or
exactly, yeah, absolutely. They had really problems figuring out how do we fit an 18-minute song on a single. So they really had to make edits to work it on a single. So, and this is Black Moses, also an iconic album.
Yeah, again with the jacket, yeah.
That was his nickname in the black community, Black Moses.
Okay.
So he named that album then.
So he built up quite a legacy around him, huh?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. He already passed away, sadly, a couple of years ago. But he left behind such a legacy. It's unbelievable.
Very politically correct guy as well, huh?
He was very much into the civil rights movement. He later on went to Scientology, but
anti-Semitism.
Yeah, but
yes, Jefferson, those are OGs to my knowledge. Yeah,
do a bit of the Gil Scott Heron.
Exactly.
Classic record, that one.
A wonderful record, wonderful. Yeah, I agree. The Jill Scott Heron, when it came out from the ERC, that really took me by surprise. I so love this record. Wow. That's an amazing piece.
From ERC, it's my favorite release.
Come again, Nadine?
From ERC, for me personally, it's my favorite release. This is a stunningly beautiful record, and it sounds, I'm saying it again, it sounds great.
Oh, here we go.
Thomas has got in front. He just picked up an armful as big as the screen. Deck of cards time.
Jill Scott Heron, here he is again. Okay, you have a few records of him. Okay.
Well, he did some quiet records.
Damn it. Look at this.
Wow.
Okay. Quite a prolific guy.
Obviously a fan of Gil Scott Heron.
It's like the Fela Kuti of soul.
Well,
it looks like about that amount of records in front of him for sure.
I really like Secrets by him, but my favorite is Pieces of a Man and The Message is also. Yeah, that's one. Cool. That's great.
Nadine, you don't know all of these records. You just cannot.
That's Michael, that's a good thing if you concentrate on one genre.
Yeah, yeah, you're right. Then it's you're right.
You know, there's like the track we just listened and like talking about Phil Spector and all that. It reminds me of one of the distinctive aspects of soul music as well, which is and one of the reasons I'm not too much into it, and maybe it's the same with Dave, that in essence it's music that is under the biggest the key element in the composition of soul is the arranger. Of course it's the voice, but then it's the arranger, the way the tracks are structured. Usually, like, if you would play on the guitar a soul song, like, that wouldn't work because there would be too many gaps between the different parts. Most of the time there are exceptions, of course, but it's the music of arrangers, which is amazing.
You're right. It's very production-led, some of it, isn't it? And that's why you can really hear the sounds of these unique producers coming through, as we say, Phil Spector, the Motown sound. It's very driven by that. And I like that. You know, it's interesting because I reckon, you know, they're all trying to have their own unique stamp, yeah, on their sound. Mm. And but yeah, no, it's interesting. It's an interesting way to think about it, Stunty, for sure.
Yeah, there is for sure this so-called Motown sound. I mean, that's legendary, right?
Yes, you have the Motown sound, you have the sound of Philadelphia, which is, yeah, in my opinion, like the 3 Degrees, the OJs, and everybody who's coming from, that's my favorite kind of 70s soul, the sound from Philadelphia, big arrangements and orchestra. But I really wanted to point out is that in soul music, you also had messages for the civil rights movement. Like, for example, Sam Cooke, Wonderful World, where he sings, I don't know about history and biology. So there were all kind of messages, Martha Reeves dancing in the streets when the riots were going on. So you really had also these kind of hidden messages within the songs.
Wow.
Hey, what do we have here?
Free Angel.
Can we play a track from Free Angel, Thomas?
Of course we can.
We can.
Can you tell us a bit about the album until Thomas starts playing?
Actually, I haven't seen that album before.
Ah, okay.
That's why I wanted him to play it.
Okay.
And Rocco is right with the producers. The performers had little to say within the 60s and the 70s. So, and also their contracts were horrible. Today, some of these people have still go onto these kind of concert circus, being 70 or 80 years old and getting themselves on stage to earn some money, because they got really screwed up by the record label, by the producers, by their management. They had like a $1 million hit, and they were only paid for the session or when they were going on concerts. That's where all the money they were getting.
Yeah, but this goes throughout the history of music and stars.
Oh, you, Michael, that goes most.
For example, when the Wham had their hit "Wake Me Up Before You Go Go," they didn't have the money to get a taxi.
But it's mostly the black Afro-American who really, really got screwed.
Really got
probably.
Yeah.
And you can see it. You can see it quite good in the Green Book, the movie. I don't know if you know this.
Yeah.
How they struggle to get to shows and get paid and everything.
Yeah, and they had to use the back door. And I recently seen a documentary from 1973 when it was called Let It Roll, where they put up some 60 stars on stage, and they said, we couldn't use hotel rooms. We might have to sleep on the streets because they wouldn't let us into the hotels. We didn't get any food. Or if a restaurant owner was kind enough, he could get through the trash and find something to eat. That was what these people were going through.
Crazy.
There's a good amount of the stars of the 60s soul stars from the US. If you go to the end of the 70s, early 80s, they're dead, in jail, or homeless.
Drug addicted, exactly. Totally right. And also what the black paint is saying, that, for example, the Funk Brothers were the backing group for most of the Motown recordings, at least before they moved to LA. So these guys never got credit. If you hear My Girl and the first part of the guitar, dum 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 dum, that was James Jamerson, and he was not getting really paid. And these guys were so kept secret, and they couldn't at least appear anywhere else because they had kind of contracts. You're only playing for Motown because that's the Motown sound. Yep. So they changed names and played for different labels and got sued by Motown. And so actually, on what's going on in 1971, Marvin Gaye was the first time he credited, we're talking 1971, Motown was late 50s, where he the first time credited the backing group with the Funk Brothers. So these people weren't rich. They were not getting rich. And also when they made arrangements or anything, they were not seeing any money, not much.
Still, let's listen to the music.
Yeah, and Angela Davis, the girl on the picture, she was a freedom fighter, and she ended up in prison as well. And that was why Larry Sanders made this album for her.
Nice.
This world today is a ball of confusion. Fighting one another, killing our innocent brothers. They talk of peace at the United Nations, trying to bring peace among all nations. They talk about war, Lord, and demonstration. But when will we learn to live together as one nation? This world, Lord, this world, this world.
So this political aspect, when did this start, or was that from the beginning?
It was very, very early on, like in the 60s. Like I said, Wonderful World with Sam Cooke, where he was singing What a Wonderful World. It's not about history. It's not about biology. There were always these hidden messages. So there was like a coexistence and relationship between the civil rights movement and the African American people. Each other tried to support. And one question, Thomas, is this record for sale in the OVC?
that's a keeper. No doubles this time.
Do we have a spare copy? Exactly.
That was a very shy.
I'm just asking for a friend.
Yeah, that's a good track on it. Yeah, I think it's funny when you said with Sam Cooke, he always did these beautiful songs, and it was not until he did "Blowing in the Wind," Bob Dylan song, he started. Changed more like into the political songs, and after that he changed and he did one of my favorite songs. I think we should just hear a few seconds of this one,
please.
He said it was Bob Dylan who make him change, like singing about himself and about his childhood and everything. So, and he got huge success with the songs like this, "Change Is Gonna Come," which become, in my opinion, one of the most famous songs from Sam Cooke nowadays. And it's one of those songs you hear every time American black people play this one at the funeral as well.
Yeah, and you have to consider it was released after he was shot. So Sam Cooke was shot, and that one was released after he died.
He just heard a few hours before, for the first time before he got shot.
Yeah.
He was out playing at a gig, and he got in to talk with a girl that, and he followed her to the hotel and got into the fight with the hotel owner and got shot that evening. This song came out.
Wow.
Yeah, and the circumstances around his death are very interesting, to say the least. So the woman said it was an accident because he screamed. The thing was, he screamed because the woman he was with stole the money. He had a couple of $1,000 cash with him, and she stole it, and he got to the receptionist of the hotel, and he was furious, and she shot him. So the circumstances around his death are, well, strange, to say the least.
She shot him 30 times. It's crazy.
Yeah, she shot 30, him.
30 yeah. times?
She oh shot my. Him. Yeah. Very, what, very
As I usually ask what Dave is drinking, Stunty, now after almost 1 hour, I have to ask you, what are you eating all the time?
Well, I just I haven't eaten all day. I've been working all day, so I'm just eating some bread. I'm sorry.
No problem. Always kidding. Guten Appetit.
About the arrangers, like to make my point even more like clear. This is someone who's very important for soul music, I would assume, David Axelrod. This is his last album he did in the early 2000s before he died in 5-6 years ago. And he came from jazz, as we talked about, but he became one of the greatest arrangers of soul music in the mid, late 60s, early 70s. And then he's also one of these arrangers who managed to have a solo career. He released quite a bunch of records that were extremely influential for mm-hmm. hip-hop in the late 80s, early 90s as well. Yeah.
So what do you see here?
This is David Axelrod.
So we have Phil Spector, we have this guy. What other arrangers do we have that are worth mentioning in this stream?
Nadine.
Well, there are quite a few, but also songwriting is, in my opinion, very important. You have Dozer Holland, Dozer. We have Bonnie Siegler, for example, who did a lot of stuff with Philadelphia International, all the great hits from Three Degrees, Instant Funk, Got My Mind Made Up, Crying, he did a lot of that. And actually, his wife called me yesterday to say thank you for the video I did about 2 years ago. So,
you're kidding. Oh, that's amazing.
I'm not kidding. And she said, thank you so much, because the thing is, especially as Rocco from Pieces of the Vinyl, is insane. Gamble and Huff, she told me, they kind of made all the money, but her husband, who was writing and constantly writing hits, he hardly saw any money from that. And in around 1967, many artists went from Philadelphia International to Celsoul because the payment was way better, and Celsoul got really huge in just a short period of time with the musicians of Philadelphia International. So I think, and also all the singers I want to mention who hardly made any money, like for example the OJs, they aren't really millionaires and sitting in their big houses. Like Santi already said, many of them are or most of them are homeless or not having enough money from their work.
And what did they do later on? They made YouTube channels or what?
Well, later on they tried to find regular jobs to get food and on the table.
But to understand why they didn't have any money, like the most usual trick that is historically documented is they would be assigned managers. And so they would get a fee when there was the recording. And for royalties, usually the managers would withhold the royalties till the point that the artist ended up in financial trouble. And then they would offer, I'll buy your royalties. I'll be the beneficiary. Here's some money, because they understood that in the long run, they would benefit way more. So they basically, there's been a lot of trials in the early 2000s from different soul R&B artists who were just like, but I had no idea. I was clueless. I was stupid. I was uninformed, basically, and tricked by people whose job was not to be a manager, but to actually profit from others.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, this carries through from soul If you think about the house, you know, think about Chicago, and there's legendary stories about label, you know, like Trax. And unfortunately, this is something that carries through a lot of musical scenes and genres, that this is a repeated story.
Thomas, treat us with some soul music.
Yeah, I think now I'll play a track that is different from the other soul that we heard, but it's also a track that I really, really love.
That's some sexy music.
Nadine, turn around. You want to see this?
Pretty bird. Yes, Terra is awesome. I love Terra. Do you fly high in the sky? No, you're caged, and I see you, pretty bird in a cage.
You say you don't understand. Thank you.
That was beautiful. So somebody mentioned earlier in the chat, why no Ruby Andrews on the wall? Thomas, do you have some Ruby Andrews, like Black Ruby? Here is the, I brought on the cover so you can see. Maybe we can play a track of a Ruby Andrews. And yes, it's signed.
Yes. You have so much, but everything is in the same with the same pencil. How many years do you have the same pencil? How is that possible?
I buy them antenna packs. It's always the same adding silver because it doesn't smear or anything. And I always send the pen with them. So I know how to, you know, that they're not signing on a black cover with a black pen, which also happened. So I always sending the pen. I'm always taking silver addings. I have like a bunch of them up here. So, and this is how that happened.
So And they, when I see your signed records, they really get into it. It's not so in 2 seconds. It's almost like an art.
How again, Michael?
He means it's not like Novak Djokovic that after a tennis game.
Exactly. That's what I meant. Yeah.
So the thing is, when I'm sending those records, if I finally track these people down, is that I'm writing a letter, and sometimes I write my number on it, and they call me and I said, okay, I have now these records. Who are you from? How did you find these records? I don't even have a copy of myself.
Okay.
Send me some copies of the records, and they can hardly believe that after 50 or 60 years, somebody from Germany comes up and says, hey, I love your music. Could you please find a record? You know how that feels for them.
Okay. Yeah. You're right. Ah, that's wonderful.
Ruby.
Also Ruby. Another one. Great one. There it is. Maybe you can play a track from Black Ruby, because I've seen someone requested Black Ruby.
Yes,
please. Let's hear something.
But do me a favor and don't play Hound Dog. Don't play Hound Dog.
Why? Why?
It's a cover version of Elvis Presley's Hound Dog. Don't play Hound Dog.
What's wrong with that?
No.
I remember now. You don't like Elvis. Yeah, I forgot that.
Can hardly stand him.
Are you the person who has his coffin at the wall?
I have his coffin. I have everything.
Yeah, Rainer, we are talking. Stunty is hungry tonight. He's really hungry.
But Michael, you don't hear me eat, right?
No, but we see you eat.
We see you eat.
Don't worry, Stumpy.
I keep my mouth shut. I don't do like a, you know, popcorn.
We are kidding.
And you're right, Record Hunter was Big Mama Thornton, and That's All Right was from Arthur Kruder, but I think Elvis' version is more famously. And he also left out a verse from the original version from Big Mama Thornton on his recording.
So the slightest mistake is already covered up within seconds from the gallery. You guys are unbelievable. You're right, Marius. They start with dessert.
That is propaganda.
But French people eat like 6 hours. So when they have dinner, it was like 6 hours dinner, and I was like, holy shit.
I'll tell you what, Nadine, when I was a kid, when I used to go to my family in Bretagne when I was a kid, we'd arrive to the great aunts by lunchtime, and the lunchtime would be over because it was time for the 4 o'clock when you eat cakes and all that.
Tea time
was over because it was time for dinner, so it was like straight up like 8 hours of eating and cooking. That was a nightmare.
sounds amazing for one day. That's nice.
Okay, yeah, when you
ready when you are, Thomas. No, I'm the DJ. I think there is no Curtis Mayfield on the wall, but there is Curtis Mayfield at the OBC shop. So if you want them, but I don't know if it's sold already. I'm not sure.
Probably it's gone already.
I don't know.
Maybe. They go like this.
Some Curtis Mayfield. Okay.
Maybe you could play Choice of Color by Curtis Mayfield.
It's so funny. You mention an artist, and 5 seconds later,
and Thomas and me, we know. El Pippa Stenzi. I know that Hound Dog was written by Jerry Lieber because he was kind enough.
Wait a second, Nadine. Let's yes, Thomas. Yes. No, I cannot put two of you. Sorry.
No worries.
No, you're not.
So, yes, I know that it was written by Jerry Lieber and another artist. He was kind enough to sign my original copy from Hound Dog. And he also has written, hold on. Don't ask me why the other ones I couldn't tear apart from the wall by now.
Okay. But Nadine, why do you have those in frames and not in a shelf?
Because they look tremendously well if you have like 20 of these on hanging on the wall.
Okay.
I have a whole box. But Thomas, do you do me a favor and please play Choice of Colors from The Impressions with featuring Curtis Mayfield?
Which album is it from?
But let's not forget, because I think he asked for that for quite some time, even on the late last stream. Joe with the with his record, what was it?
I think Magnum, wasn't it Magnum?
Magnum, thank you, Nadine.
Yeah. Don't forget about Magnum. This is a holy grail of mine, which I haven't found yet.
Nadine, don't overdo the request, because when we do the industrial music segment, we might go very deep in the request if you.
Yeah, but it's for me, it's so like, oh my God, I love showing people how beautiful this music is. So I'm sorry if I'm getting
No, I don't think that's what Stunty meant. I think Stunty loves the way he takes this. I'm quite sure. Okay, can you play a track from this album, Thomas?
Yes, I can. I think this album is also one I love to listen to because it's different from all the other soul albums I have. Every song has some jazzy elements, some rock element. It's very different, and it's worth listening to the whole album. It's not like there's one track that you play out, but it's a really, really good album.
You know, there's the saying of the so-called perfect album. Would you call this a perfect album, Thomas?
Yeah, it's close to be a perfect album. Nice. The recording of it is not that amazing, or the record, the pressing of it. Mm-hmm. So it's not like something as good as it could be. But it's this one looks near mint, but it plays VG VD Plus. But I think I opened it up. It was sealed when I got it.
Okay. Can you turn it up a little bit?
The jazzy element of this one, isn't there? A big crossover with the jazz style. Yeah.
It is different, right?
I love it.
Very jazzy.
It's an album that is a little bit in all directions.
Yeah.
Funky.
Amazing. Funky. Yeah. Jazz. Okay,
yeah. Groovy. Evolution. What a solution. Evolution. What a solution. The generation across the nation. World regeneration across the nation. You're going to make it right. I think all tracks are good on this one, and nothing sounds the same. They have a different prose and
disco devil. And Nadine, would you agree that soul without a little funk is like peanut butter without the jelly?
No, she won't.
You know, I think this goes back to what Stunty said earlier about sort of pure soul, but the amount of fusion types of records are with soul and jazz, soul and funk. You know, and you could probably condense down what records you could say are sort of pure soul records to, you know, fewer, where it was actually much broader with the crossover with styles. And a lot of artists, you know, as we know, and we talked about this before, there are a lot of jazz artists that sessioned on soul records, you see, or what are considered soul records. So, yeah, it's interesting to hear this, where
let me play devil's advocate. When a genre comes to a dead end, then they start fusion. Am I wrong?
I don't think it was so much like that with, because, you know, musicians, a good example is that Gil Scott Heron piece of The Man. You know, you've got Ron Carter on there, right? And I just think there's a lot of styles that they just generally, hearing some of that, I sort of had visions of Strata East records, sort of hearing elements, almost a spiritual sound. So I think there's kind of, you're right, you know, I just think it's just the natural way that music progresses like this. And you go back to the 60s, it's very pure soul. But then when you get into the 70s, you start to get more of this sort of fusion of styles going on.
Yes, I agree. Very well put. Thomas, I have a wish too, because I don't know if everybody knows this song, but now, thanks to the ERC release, I know it. When you have the time, the first song on the Jill Scott Heron, Me and Names, the first song, Side A, I would love to hear that.
The revolution won't be televised.
Won't be televised. Thank you very much. Yeah, that is a wonderful song. And is this funk, Nadine? Is this soul?
It kind of is, but you have to consider this is, he covered himself, because he released a song on another album before that, but he was, when he started, he was doing it with bongos. Yes, I think, yeah, that's the one. Okay. He did with bongos, and he did like a poetry to it. And later on, when he did Pieces of a Man, he did redid the song.
It's almost like for me. It's
he was one together with the Last Poets. He was one of the people who kind of had a lot of influence into hip-hop.
But would you say that true soul music, like pure soul music, is probably closer to gospel music rather than funk?
Exactly, yes. I would absolutely say that.
Gospel. It's important to go back to the roots, right?
So the roots is gospel.
Yeah, okay. like Sam Cooke was a gospel singer before he got into soul and pop. So the roots are absolutely into gospel music. And every kind of artist I featured on my weekly videos had their roots in gospel music. So they were all going to the church each Sunday, or their parents were pastors, and they were all having their roots in gospel music. For example, Aretha Franklin's father was also a gospel preacher. So they all had their things. And Thomas is also having a record from Caroline Franklin on the wall, who is actually a sister. So she was also a great songwriter. She never made it big, because if your sister is Aretha Franklin, it's kind of difficult. But she released some beautiful, that's some beautiful recordings. So Caroline Franklin. Home is Where Hatred Is. El Pasdenzi, I hope I spell your name correct. For Esther Phillips, it was a huge hit. She was, I think, nominated for Grammy, I think. She lost against Aretha Franklin, but Aretha Franklin later on gave her that award, because she thought that Home Is Where the Hatred Is, where she sang, it was better. Because Esther Phillips was also a drug addict, so she knew what she was singing about.
I'm under the impression, Nadine, that you're into vinyl and into soul, kind of.
Tiny little bit.
Tiny little bit.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials, because the revolution will not be televised.
Cool, this is so cool. Wow.
The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Xerox in four parts without commercial interruptions. The revolution will not show you pictures of Nixon blowing a bugle and leading a charge by John Mitchell, General Abrams, and Spiro Agnew to eat hog maws confiscated from a Harlem sanctuary. The revolution will not be televised. Revolution will not be brought to you by the Schaefer Award Theater and will not star Natalie Woods and Steve McQueen or Bullwinkle and Julia. The Revolution will not give your mouth sex appeal. The Revolution will not get rid of the nubs. The Revolution will not make you look 5 pounds thinner, because the Revolution will not be televised, brother. There will be no pictures of you and Willie Mae pushing that shopping cart down the block on the dead run, or trying to slide that color TV into a stolen ambulance.
Sold out within 8 seconds, probably. The original is not such a bad choice nowadays.
I played the hell out of that ERC all day, for 5 days in a row. I had it on constant rotation.
When you listen to that Gil Scott-Heron track, there's one influence that is quite obvious that I was thinking about earlier, but didn't know where to mention that. But it's and that was not just on soul music, but on the world, and that maybe helped people to seek out that music. It's Martin Luther King. I had a dream. That is like almost a solo a cappella in a way, and everyone in the world heard that. And that influenced everyone in pop music, in popular music. Or not everyone, but that was impossible to escape it. Not that you should.
And there's a great story behind that speech, is actually that when Martin Luther King was about to speak, Mahalia Jackson was with him when he did that speech. And she said, "No, Martin, you have to tell the people what your dream is. You said you had a dream. Talk about that dream. Please, Martin, do that." And Mahalia Jackson was actually the one who said, "Tell them about your dream." And that's where your "I have a dream" comes from. That was actually also with the help of Mahalia Jackson. God bless her.
So you'd agree it is an important
absolutely piece of history for the soul music. Absolutely. For the African American people, this speech is so important, and also on musical influence. I'm totally with you on this. It's had a huge influence, that speech. Oh, we could talk for hours. Oh my God.
Stunty, can you take over 30 seconds with the...
So
Michael is gonna go poo-poo right now.
Can we listen to this when Nadine freaked out?
So Lee Moses, this was his only album release, and it was released on Marvel, which was a sub-label of All Platinum. And he unfortunately did only this album, and he also appeared with Jimi Hendrix. And also later on, when there were Jimi Hendrix albums released, he was actually the guitar player. He couldn't really make it big. Nowadays, he has huge influence on many musicians, but this one is... Oh my God, if you find that one, it's now like a grand, if you find it. But there are some reissues out, and there's also a documentary about Lee Moses. This album is just stunningly great from the beginning to the end.
Can we hear it?
Yes, absolutely, Thomas. Let's hear, like, he had a version of California Dreaming on that one.
He did?
Yep. Ah! Thomas!
Around and the sky of green.
Oh.
I went for a walk, yes I did, on a winter day. I've been saving more.
Thomas, wow. Can you do me a favor and please play a small portion of the second song of the first side, which is Got That Will? It's the second song on the first side.
Nadine, it's the music we just heard. It's a good reminder also that you were talking about Sam Cooke. Well, Jimi Hendrix had one of his biggest first gigs with Sam Cooke. He was the guitar player for Sam Cooke.
The backing group, exactly. But actually, Jimi Hendrix's main influence was actually Elvis. So he decided to become a guitar player when he saw Elvis.
Okay, you win, Nadine. You win.
Okay, you win.
You win. So hearing this from you is a great honor. Yeah, Free at Last. And he made Hey Joe. He made also a great version of Hey Joe. So actually, if you find that album as an original, it's almost impossible. But it's available as a reissue. Go and grab it. I can proudly say I own original.
Of course you do.
Liam, I don't like you today.
Thank you for your opinion, Rob Walker.
Got that wheel to learn. Gonna be a star one day. Got that wheel to learn. My name is gonna be on top. But let me tell you about it. Slide the fabulous snow.
Oh, I just bought a copy. I just bought a copy of this album.
The reissue or the original?
Of course, a reissue, but there is a beautiful reissue on the on the Great Great Lake. It's fantastic.
Yeah, here's a reissue, the first reissue. It's a double album as a reissue, and it has 10 tracks that is not on the original. So a lot of tracks that doesn't appear anywhere else is only on this reissue. So okay. The reissue is actually also worth finding.
Yeah, because he did a couple of singles, and I think the singles are also included on the reissue. I consider myself a very proud owner, and somebody had to really in Den Bosch talk me into buying this record because I kind of listened to it. It wasn't my style, and he said, "You believe me, you want that record." And I brought it home and listened to it, and I said, "Oh my God,
just, thank you." Just last year, Light in the Attic did a reissue of it.
He is so great. Lee Moses. Oh, my God.
We hear a little bit more from one of the tracks.
Nadine, how much did you pay for the record?
I forgot.
Money text.
What was the lady, Michael?
I'm afraid that we go on with this terrible soul music. I'm starting to like
it. I'm DJ said it quite right. I'm the DJ.
Michael, you have to watch some of those British Wigan casinos. You can start learning some of the moves that they used to do.
Yeah. You start.
And then, you
okay, I will. You start and I go with you.
No, that's not gonna work. It's Dave. He's like, this is a drug addict music. You'd rather have ice cold. So.
We can't go to a million places.
Nice.
We can't be around for a million places. Taking this giant soul, this I know.
Give it some time. Sorry, Thomas, say again.
I say the whole album is amazing. All the tracks are.
Will we see a copy at the OBC shop, or is that in this case
can
not?
Can I make a deal with you and say I will put this one up on the OBC for three days?
Yeah.
Because I don't want to sell it, but if somebody buy it within 3 days, they have a chance.
Okay.
But that's the reissue, right?
That's the original OG.
Oh, okay, guys, your chance.
I'm keeping refreshing the site. I keep refreshing. I'm on it. I'm not joking. I'm refreshing right now.
Thomas, that's very kind of you for the OBC people to sell that one.
Yeah, because wow. I will keep it forever. But it's I will put it up 3 days. It's not cheap, but.
Mm-mm.
As if it would last 3 days. Come on, Thomas. Come on.
And on this
Peter, it's not some of those really expensive records, you don't sell them within seconds. You know, it might be different with this one.
And you have to consider everybody.
Josh D now sells his kit.
I totally get that. What you get up here is a great opportunity because for a long time, yes, on the Marble, great. For a long time, you couldn't even find this record on Discogs for a long time. So when they pop up, it's not cheap and you hardly find them.
Wow.
This record is mind-blowing.
It is. I really love this format so that we all can listen to this. But, you know, usually we say, oh, this is unbelievable. This is great. It sounds so beautiful. The songs are so cool. But now that I could listen to it, it's a completely different ballgame for me. That's really
it's a nice dream. And everyone can take something away from it, learn something. Yeah.
There's one thing I wanted to ask Nadine, though. Because the song we just listened to, it's fairly obvious where like sexuality stands, but in like more like traditional pure soul music, considering that it's coming from gospel, like where do you think like the body, like the sexuality of the music, if there is any?
I think in soul music there's a lot of sexuality, also like in rock and music, like Tutti Frutti. It's about an orgy of people from different colors. You remember the Tutti Frutti eyes having different layers and colors? So that means it was an orgy. So I do think that soul music is also very sexual. Absolutely. Yeah,
I was asking because most like pure soul music is not heavy on the drums.
On the drugs?
On the drums.
On the drums, yes. It depends. Motown was very, very much on drums.
Yeah, it's more rhythm and blues, Motown, though.
Yeah, but sexuality in music for me is not coming from drums. But you have to consider it's very rhythmic. But rhythmic also comes from the voices, how you sing a song, especially in gospel music. You have a lot of rhythm within their voices and they're clapping their hands. So there are a lot of hidden messages within soul. And also for the civil rights movement I mentioned before, you have a lot of hidden messages in between. And that was a possibilities for singers and people to bring messages out there, if it's in a sexual way or if it's in a political way, to bring that to the people. It's kind of hidden in the music. And that's what I also think is very fascinating about it.
I was thinking about that since as it's coming from gospel music, maybe it was actually soul music is... You know, the step like instilling sexuality in gospel before it becomes really evident in like rhythm and blues and funk and stuff like that.
Yeah, absolutely.
The transitional.
Yeah, it's that. It's a net for me, but it is a natural happening coming from gospel music. And also you have to consider that the preachers back then the African American churches, you know. They knew, you know, so I don't have to go into detail, but that's an actual natural process for me, how it developed.
Who hasn't been touched by a nice priest, huh?
I now have to think of Elvis Presley's gospel album, He Touched Me.
This is so bad. This is so wrong.
It is. Thomas, I hope you didn't hear this. I really do hope you didn't.
Thomas, somebody mentioned tech scam labels. So Thomas has at least one I've seen. Very rare. Is it for sale?
Which one was that?
The one with the naked woman on the... holding it in your hands. You're looking right at you.
Oh.
With those tech scam labels, Nadine, you're talking, right?
Yep.
This one, yeah.
Tomorrow's People. I do have the reissue, never seen one in the wild. Tech scam labels, super rare. Yeah.
Play something from it. Yeah.
Oh my God, Liam.
Yeah.
So clueless.
Come on, Stanty.
No, he was making a joke.
Thank you.
smooth.
Yeah. You know, I have to admit, I was a little bit afraid for the Soul Stream before I did it. But as I said, I love it more and more and more now.
Really, Dave was much more afraid than you, Michael. He
Dave is me always, like, Dave is always much more afraid.
It's a pure education for me, this one. By the way, yeah. I reckon that last one was the best so far.
What makes you say that? Just a taste thing?
I like the whole, you know, I look at the thing like the cover, the name, mm-hmm. I just like the whole way it's presented. And also, it sounded really good to me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It sounded really cool. Is there something with that one for me? So, yeah, nice. I'm going to have to be looking out for those tax scams, I think.
Yeah, that was my next question that I would have asked you anyhow. Are you aware of these tax scam labels Nadine is talking about when it comes to soul music?
Never seen one, so, you know.
Maybe Nadine, get once more into it, because I think the topics is one of these two, right?
Yeah, there were a couple made, but one important question, Thomas, is this one for sale? Will you put it up in the store?
I think there's three on Discogs you can buy.
No.
Starting
I have in the OBC, I have free shipping.
I think, you know, on Discogs they start at 2,500, so it's not an easy record to find.
Okay, wow. We talk later. Keep it. Don't sell it.
Someone mentioned the Dean Stack. Where's the Dean Stack today? It should be going through the
room. Yeah, it's going higher and higher and higher. The Stack will be legendary at some point. But Nadine, again, tech scam labels.
What was done in the 70s was that bigger record labels founded another label which wasn't making any profit. So they could write them off and saying, yeah, but listen, we don't make any profit with it. And so they had to make sure that they're not paying too much taxes. So what they put on is, and then you always see these covers with like random pictures, like the one I showed in the beginning with the car on it, with the truck.
Stock photos, right?
Stock pictures they use from women. So you have various pictures, like the same covers with the same picture, because they use these kind of pictures to make it as cheap as possible. They weren't really pressed many. They weren't really marketing or anything. They didn't want to have the records being successful. So they always could say, we have a label up here which doesn't make any profit, and write it off to the bigger company. And those records are so often so great, like the Topics Giving Up, for example. But there are a number of more, for example, from the TSG label, or other labels that did that in the past, and that's why they are so sought after, and that's one of the reasons. So, and the music on these records is just mind blowing, and Thomas has one.
There's a really good reissue out.
From Peavine, yes, I know, I have it.
I think Floating Point made a reissue as well, of it with a different cover.
Yeah, I do have the phone from Peavine. It's hold on, I have it up here. I have it all, thanks to my shelves. I have it up here. This is my Peavine reissue.
Okay, see, so.
Yeah, but the reissue is not for me, in my opinion.
I know.
The same as the iconic one. The iconic original one.
You just want the original. You just need the original.
I would love, let's put it that way. I would love to have them as an original, because I, you know, for me, it's having the iconic version of it. It's the same with the Barbara Haywood, where I was looking for 20 years to get that. And when I finally had it, I can't tell you how I felt and how I celebrated it. And when I got home and I put it on my turntable and I made myself open up a little champagne and enjoy that, and all that feeling for that record. I really celebrate that when you have finally found your grail, if it's expensive or not, that you really celebrate the music. Mm. And that's for me.
And what a good excuse to drink more alcohol, right?
I don't need an excuse. We have so many live streams, Michael. I don't need an excuse.
We are live almost on a daily basis. It's not only on my
our vinyl community. Tea.
So when you say I drink Lily,
it's the tea. It's only tea.
Okay, we are into music now.
Please.
Yes, my skin is black, but that's no reason to hold me back.
Why don't you think about it, 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 think about it? Once in reserve, just like you. So move on aside, because I'm coming through. Oh,
no matter how hard you try,
you can't stop me now.
Yeah, that's Whatnuts. They made three albums, and this track is one of the most famous one. But and those are not expensive records. Those you can get for 15, 30 euro.
Nice.
Really nice. But then they made a Holy Grail, which is really rare. This one.
Yeah. Okay. So there is this one album, like so often, right, from one band. That is the one.
And it's not the best album, but it has some crazy drums that I love. Dave will know.
Yeah, Dave, come on, give us the crazy drums. Dave will love it.
We've got to hit Thomas, please. We've got to hear.
Want to hear the heavy
drums? We want to hear that, Dave. Right? We for sure want to hear that.
the track is when the drums comes. The track is halfway through. It start up a little bit. I'll say it start like this.
Why must the color of my skin determine what bag I'm in?
Although my skin is... And it keep on going this for like 3-4 minutes, and then it goes into some really nice drums here.
There we go, that's the bit. Thomas drum sticker. Thomas drum sticker.
Yeah, well, it's wonderful.
The drums, but do you listen to the bass, the bass line? Oh my god. Wow. Amazing.
And it continued for 3 or 4 minutes more.
For me, this is one of my favorites of the evening so far. That was really, really kind of crazy and special. Yeah. Oh, that was cool. Dave,
you know, Michael,
enjoyed it?
Oh yeah, though, very much so. Very marvelous. Enjoyed the. I'm enjoying the whole stream, Michael.
That's nice. Sandy, sorry, yeah?
No, I was just saying when we were listening to this, like, I guess there was a time in the 60s, 70s where when they really like reverb, right?
Yeah, they loved reverb. In many, on the chorus, on the guitars, on the main vocals, that was a thing. That was before the wah-wah came in, the wah-wah effect everybody used when they had also this little thing in their mouth and they made those crazy sounds with that, yeah.
Hey, Stunty, just going back to that, you know, you mentioned reverb. Think of Phil Spector, yeah?
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
Again, all the sound concept, yeah? Very much reverb-driven to create that almost like a, you know, it's that whole wash of sound, isn't it, behind it? And it's true, and it's very, but I think that's very perceptive to mention that. It's soul music. It's definitely reverb-heavy behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Yeah, very cool.
Here's a question for Thomas, and I know you love those questions. Usually you need the jacket, the cover art, right? Do you have Cannonball's soul opera, Big Man?
Yeah.
You love those questions, right?
I collected Cannonball, but I cannot remember what Big Man is. I'll just look it up here. I need to see the picture.
Yeah, exactly. I know.
Thomas always has that excuse in case he doesn't know.
Yeah, Justin Peters mentioned that even the studios had their own unique reverb sound they created.
Yeah, sometimes, you know, the reverb was a whole room. You'd have the spring reverb, like a small room, albeit, but like a reverb can be very, like if you have a spring reverb, the spring can be as long as you want, which will give you a longer reverb. And yeah, this studio, they had like a room dedicated to that with a custom-built reverb that they could then assign to different channels during the recording.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
That's it. Exactly. You know, sometimes I it takes a second to change.
We were waiting for the reverb of your speech, but
you know, I have no neural link to my Mac right now, so it takes.
We should be applying reverb to all of us because of this stream, I think. You know, we should all be on reverb. It would be quite cool.
Mary Queen's Lions, Soul Fever, Thomas. Probably same answer. I need to see the jacket. And I so understand that.
Yeah, and Michael, you have seen the jacket with me as well. When we were in Den Bosch, I saw this record. And I kind of asked for the prize, and you kind of dragged me away from that stall because I already spent so much money.
Yeah, I remember. I tried to protect you. I remember.
Yeah, and that was so right.
You were on a buying spree that day.
Yeah, that was so right. And here it is.
You know what happened when Nadine was shopping at Den Bosch? Dealers came to me and said, "I give you 100 euros if you get this young lady to my booth." No, I'm kidding, of course. Soul Fever.
That's a great one. There's also a great reissue which is coming out, which includes an interview with her. So the original is pricey. And then Bosch, I've seen one for 600 euros. And this is a great album. Hard to find. So
which song, Nadine? You want to hear a specific song or...?
I want Thomas to choose because he has a great taste. Yeah, maybe Dimitri's the first song.
First song, okay.
What's going on? You didn't want to let him choose the song until now, and now you say he has good taste? What's changed suddenly?
He thought that he might play a song one as well.
Yeah.
Did he want the first on side A or B? I'll play a little bit of this one.
Side A, I think.
The side B I got on here.
But when a kiss may fever, that's for me.
Well, I know that word.
Never know I'm but a looking. Never know I'm but a looking. When you put your arms around me, feeling that the heart of everything will be good. When you kiss me, fever when you hold me tight.
Fever in the morning.
Fever all through,
the night. You give me fever.
Romeo, love, Juliet.
Was yesterday. I get up in the morning after crying all night long, laughing and talking.
Yeah, he has a good voice. I like it.
Yeah.
Nice.
She only made a couple of 45s and only this one album. It never really took off when it was released. But damn, this is a great album.
I have an album here that I'm interested in if Dave knows this one. Because it's half a reggae album.
Is it now? So is it? It looks a bit. The cover looks very cool. I love the typography that's used. Wow, look at that! And you've got a leaping ram on the back. What's not to like about it? It's got our good music.
only a British could put that like this. That was so beautiful, British. I love it. What is there not to like? That was splendid, Dave.
I don't know it, Thomas, so please enlighten me. So you say it's a bit reggae, so where does this come from then? Are we talking
it's American, and it's half soul and half reggae.
Well, there we go, great combination.
Yeah, and I even think he do a Bob Marley song on here as well. It's not easy to see because half of the cover is
okay.
But I'll play a few seconds from the soul and then I'll play some reggae after.
Cool.
Some drums.
That was for sure the soul part.
Yeah, I'll jump a little bit to the next track.
Shibab, shibab, my baby. Shibab, shibab, hello, stranger. Shibab, shibab, my baby.
And then it's a little bit half reggae, half soul in
the song. Half soul, right. But they also mentioned country and rock on the jacket. So
yeah. He also do this one.
No woman no cry.
No woman no cry.
Probably get nailed, no? Yeah. But amazing.
It's a weird record, but it's
where did you find this record? This is wow, and I think even Nadine doesn't know it.
Correct.
Okay, we can end the stream. We can end the stream now. Goal is reached.
Nadine doesn't know a record.
Doesn't know a solo record.
Yeah, because I wouldn't have picked it up because it includes a reggae. I love the reggae beats, but I'm not the biggest reggae person. There's some great reggae tunes out there. I know it's a very appreciated genre, but it's not so much my cup of tea. But I really love his voice. It's a very smooth voice. I love the voice.
Yeah. It's funny though, because when we were talking about reverb in soul music, that's where my mind instantly went, like how that must mean there's a connection between reggae and soul music.
There absolutely is a connection, but somehow for me, I tried a lot of times getting into reggae, but for me it's not so much my thing.
I mean, Lover's Rock is soul music essentially.
Yeah.
Just to mention, just going back, so I remember I showed these before, but you know, Obama Records in the UK, they were putting out reggae, but they were also putting out soul compilations, and that shows the connection that they were looking. You know, both genres were being represented on that label, and the same with Island Records as well. Early Island Records did the same thing. So it's a combination of reggae, R&B. And soul. So there is a definite, you know, there's a definite connection between all of these.
I think Thomas is putting on a record. Looks like
you want music. Drums?
We need drums. Give us some drums.
A bit slower than still Thomas.
Dedicated to the United Nations. And especially the young people.
That's my favorite record of the night so far.
Thomas, quick thing here. I noticed that was on Savoy Records, and I associate Savoy with jazz, right?
It's so a gospel, gospel album, actually. Savoy also, Savoy released many gospel albums as well.
Oh, right.
Sorry? So in the
70s. Is it the same label we're talking about that did all the jazz records, but they did gospel early? I'm curious, because it looked like an original Savoy to me.
Maybe, Thomas, you can show the label again, if we're talking about the same Savoy, because Savoy released mainly gospel albums. I have many gospel albums from Savoy, and it's actually a gospel album. It's one of those funky gospel albums.
Yes, so, yeah. Savoy did a lot, like 130 jazz albums. And then they had the number...
You know, the Sun Ra, famous Sun Ra on there. There's some great jazz on Savoy. Great jazz records.
They did, and I think some of them are really, really one of my best jazz records. And then they did 14,100 series with his gospel records.
Well, there we go. You see, that's crazy. Brilliant. Again, we get the connections going on here. You see, I didn't know that.
And this one is gospel record, I think number 236. So there's a lot of gospel on Savoy. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of good Savoy gospel records as well.
Yeah.
And I think.
Okay. 2 hours. 2 hours flew by. I would say we go into the last round of records. Thomas has an armful record. Okay. Here we go. I think now comes the boy gospel record.
This is actually 10,000. It's called the 12,000 series.
Bull's Blood record label, the Blood Red label, is the one that everyone wants.
And I like the artwork a little bit like a Blue Note. They kept to the same artwork. A few of them were colored, but most of them were black and white colors.
Okay.
So I think we can take Savoy and talk about both jazz and gospel at the same time at some point. There's a lot of really, really, all the stars were playing on Charlie Parker here. Kai Winding.
They've got lovely covers, Thomas, those ones.
They really got lovely covers. I like that.
This reminds me a lot of the Pablo covers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, the typing, and this is reminds me a lot of the Pablo.
But this is like the quality of Pablo. It's a heavy cardboard. It's a heavy vinyl. It's a, while Pablo is more like a cheaper way of setting both the cover and the records. Like this is nearly Blue Note quality.
Nice.
But we can take that in one stream, but that's a lot of really nice things to listen to.
But maybe Thomas, we can wrap up the stream, because Michael mentioned it at the beginning, because he loved the cover so much, is with the Skulls, which is also a very rare record. Finding this one in good condition is super difficult. So maybe we wrap this show up with a track from the Skull.
Yeah,
this show. Nice.
And it's a promo.
This is unbelievable. Wow. And this is a soul record. I mean, this more looks like a death metal record in a way. Yeah, this is unbelievable.
Yes, I've seen that one in Den Bosch like 3 or 4 times, totally beaten up for a ridiculous amount of money. So, and this one looks like, oh my God, is it in a shop?
Yeah,
it is.
Oh.
It's all can find it in very different places. This is probably my favorite soul record.
Yeah,
Michael.
It's
cool. I know that. Yeah. Why do I know that?
Yeah, it's Ape of Naples by Coil.
Ah, okay.
The way John Byrne sings on this is 100% influenced by soul. This is after he actually took some singing lessons.
Finally, something. No, I'm kidding.
Not nurse's wound, but close enough.
Okay, before we get into the last track of the evening, let me again all thank you so much. Dave, nice take as always, and I hope you could get some new facts. That was amazing. Thank you, Nadine. Oh, that's great. Nadine, thank you for, in a way, putting us through this evening. That was so cool.
I enjoyed it tremendously, Michael. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, Peter. I don't know for what, but hey.
Thanks for having me again and again and again.
Stanti, thank you. I hope you are not hungry anymore. Have a
I will be like a. You know, I've been your guest, so you know, food is
important.
Yeah, it's important. Yeah, and I'll see you on. On Sunday, Michael.
Why? What is on Sunday?
Hopefully, France, Germany again.
I don't know. I don't think so. Thomas, and of course, huge thank you to you, because in a way, you are the motor of this shop. And thank you for putting up all those records and gave us a wonderful impression of fantastic soul music. Next week, we will be up with another topic, which will probably as interesting as this one. And yeah, let's get into the final track of the evening.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Thomas. That was awesome.
Thank you.
Yeah. I had the time of my life. Thank you so much.
And now, wonderful record. Highly recommended. Again with the drumming. Cool.
Get uptight.